We continue in Holy Week as we kind of pick up in the midst of this three-day-long worship service. Last night was Maundy Thursday, where we receive the mandate and the promise of Christ in the Lord's Supper. From there, our Lord was arrested, charged, and we pick up in Matthew chapter 27, the morning of Good Friday. When Pilate saw that he was getting nowhere, but that instead an uproar was starting, he took water and he washed his hands in front of the crowd. "I am innocent of this man's blood," he said. "It is your responsibility." And all the people answered, "Let his blood be on us and on our children." Then he released Barabbas to them. But he had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified. Then the governor's soldiers took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole company of soldiers around him. They stripped him, put a scarlet robe on him, and then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on his head. They put a staff in his right hand and knelt in front of him and mocked him. "Hail, King of the Jews," they said. They spit on him and took the staff and struck him on the head again and again. After they had mocked him, they took off the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him. Let's rise for the invocation. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Let us ever walk with Jesus. To behold the gift of his forgiveness. To marvel at the magnitude of his mercy. The place of the skull. Faithful Lord, with me abide,
I shall follow where you guide.
Continue in song.
Christ,
At this hour, the church remembers the unfathomable death of our Lord Jesus Christ, the death that he willingly took upon himself to take away our sins. It truly is a reminder of the magnitude of our sin, and at the same time, the great value that he places on us and our salvation. And so as we reflect on this awesome gift that God has given, we can do no better than to borrow the language of Jesus as we thank our dearest friends. He has made us his forever, and his love will never end. Let us pray. Merciful and everlasting God, you did not spare your only Son, but delivered him up for us all to bear our sins on the cross. Grant that our hearts may be so fixed with steadfast faith in him that we fear not the power of sin, death, and the devil. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Congregation, please be seated.
Down the Via Dolorosa in Jerusalem that day, the soldiers tried to clear the narrow street, but the crowd pressed in to see a man condemned to die on Calvary. He was bleeding from a beating. There were stripes upon his back, and he wore a crown of thorns upon his head. And he bore with every step the scorn of those who cried out for his death. Down the suffering, like a lamb came the Messiah, Christ the King. But he chose to walk that road out of his love for you and me. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the way to Calvary. Por la via dolorosa, triste día Jerusalén, los soldados le bien paso a Jesús. Mas la gente se acercaba para ver aquel acaba que la cruz. Por la vía dolorosa que las vía del dolor, como ve a vino Cristo, Rey Señor. Like a lamb came the
The first word, according to Luke chapter 23, verses 33 and 34. When they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him, along with the criminals, one on his right and the other on his left. And Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." They divided up his clothes by casting lots.
Lord Jesus Christ, in your sinlessness, you never needed forgiveness, and yet you forgive those who sinned against you without cause. Give us grace and courage to forgive those who wrong us, that we may so draw attention to your forgiving glory and the cross. Amen.
The second word, according to Luke chapter 23, verses 39 through 43. One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God," he said, "since you are under the same sentence? We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus answered him, "I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise."
Thank you. Lord Jesus, remember us in your kingdom, that we, too, may be with you in paradise. Amen.
The third word, according to St. John, the 19th chapter, verses 26 and 27. When Jesus saw his mother there, the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Dear woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that time on, this disciple took her into his home.
Lord Jesus, even in your death, you put those who are lonely and neglected into families. Draw many into your family, that we may praise you together with them forever. Amen.
Fourth word, according to St. Mark, 15th chapter, 34th verse. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?"
Thank you.
Lord Jesus, Lamb of God, who take away the sins of the world, you were forsaken by your Father so that we could not be forsaken. Give us grace to rely on you, on your complete sacrifice, that we may be always trust in you and our Heavenly Father's love for us. Amen.
Let us take a moment and join our hearts in prayer. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, for indeed you are our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Friends in Christ, what you are about to hear is an R-rated sermon. And usually when we think of R-rated movies and things like this, that means that there's bloodshed, violence, and nudity. And as we move through the eyewitness account of the crucifixion, we'll see that that is absolutely the case. But R-rated refers to more, because that's the way God deals with us, always giving us more. But we begin with bloodshed, violence, and nudity. As you're aware, we walk with Jesus on this Friday we call Good to Golgotha. Golgotha is the place of the skull. Golgotha was a place where Roman soldiers would systematically maim and maul people, and then they would throw them away. Golgotha was the place of public execution, and it was also the Jerusalem city dump. Christ's crucifixion at Golgotha was certainly an act of utter brutality, an act of barbarism. Rome would call it the utterly vile death of the cross. Violence, bloodshed, and nudity are at maximum levels. As Jesus endures a scourge, a crown of thorns, a hammer, three nails. And one more R-rated idea: indecent exposure. That's certainly a part of the events of this day. Indecent exposure. Jesus is first stripped before the soldiers of Herod Antipas. He's stripped again at the command of Pilate at Gabbatha, and then he is stripped naked once more at the cross. The soldiers divide his garments by casting lots. In the events that happen in the hours between Maundy Thursday and the morning of Good Friday, Jesus prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane. St. Luke tells us in his gospel that he sweat blood. And the medical condition for that is called hematohidrosis. Hematohidrosis happens when people have psychological stress that is off the charts. Hematohidrosis makes skin extremely sensitive to touch. And so after experiencing this hematohidrosis, Jesus' skin was extremely fragile and sensitive, so that when the Romans flogged him the next day, the pain had to be unbearable. The lacerations tore into his underlying skeletal muscle tissue, producing quivering ribbons of bleeding flesh. To accomplish this, Romans use a whip of braided leather thongs with spikes woven into them, called a flagrum. This flagrum, as it's called, would strike the flesh, and the spikes would cause deep bruises and deep lacerations, and the whipping would have gone all the way from the shoulders down the back to the buttocks and even the back of the legs. The Romans were pretty good at this. They were good at a lot of things, but this might be near the top of the list. They had crucifixion down to a science. Historians tell us that between Pompey's defeat of the Jews in 69 BC and the destruction of the Second Temple in 70 AD, Rome crucified about 350,000 Jews. They'd done this a time or two. Historians also tell us that most victims of crucifixion would last about 72 hours on their cross. Jesus lasted almost 6. They had almost killed him with the whips at Gabbatha, the stone pavement that he endured earlier that morning. At Golgotha, the Romans threw Jesus on his wooden cross as it had to be carried by someone else in his place. Then they drove tapered spikes through his wrists and his feet. All the while they're mocking him and spitting on him. You know, if the nails had been driven through his palms, the weight would have caused his skin to tear, and Christ would have fallen off of that cross. So the nails instead went through his wrists. Also in his wrists were the median nerve that runs down his arm. The largest nerve going out of the hand was crushed by the pounding nails. And when Christ's feet were nailed, those nerves also were crushed. He had the pleasure of feeling it the entire time he was up there. Our Savior's arms were stretched out as well, 6 inches upward, intentionally dislocating his shoulders. The stress of Christ's diaphragm then forced his chest into an inhaling position. So in order to exhale, he would have to push up using his feet to relieve the pressure on his diaphragm and temporarily exhale, force the air out of his lungs. And in doing so, the nails would tear through his feet, eventually locking up against the bones themselves, his tarsals. And for 6 hours, this breathing motion continued. Christ scraping his shredded back against the coarse wood of his cross until he would become completely exhausted and unable to push himself up for another breath. As Jesus slowed down his breathing, he went into a respiratory acidosis, as it's called, and that leads to an irregular heartbeat. In fact, with his heart beating so erratically, Jesus would know that death was near. And so when Jesus died, he actually died of cardiac arrest. R-rated, isn't it? Bloodshed, violence, and nudity. But these R-rated events on a Friday that we call good lead to R-rated gifts. And if it weren't for that, there is no way that we could call Good Friday good, because it most certainly wasn't. R-rated events lead to R-rated gospel gifts for us. And the first gift that we have is redemption. Redeemed. From the sixth hour there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. This is what Matthew tells us. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, my God, why have you forsaken me? Matthew, as he records these words, is using Roman time. The Roman trial with Pontius Pilate began about 6 a.m., and it took the Romans only 3 hours to prepare Jesus for crucifixion, so that he was nailed on the cross about 9 a.m., or the third hour of the day. That would make the sixth hour noon. The ninth hour would be 3 p.m. The 3 hours of darkness was not a solar eclipse, as some have speculated. The darkness indicates the Father's judgment against Jesus, because our Savior was carrying the weight of the sin of the world. St. Paul captures it well. He says that God made him who knew no sin to be sin for us. We continue with the fifth word from John chapter 19. Later, knowing that all was now completed, and so that the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, I am thirsty.
Lord Jesus Christ, King of the Jews and King of all nations, you have promised that those who hunger and thirst for righteousness would be satisfied. Give us faith to trust that your thirst on the cross supplies all that we need. Amen.
The sixth word, according to St. John, chapter 19, verse 30. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, it is finished. And with that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.
Lord Jesus, you could have found the pain to be too much. You could have come down from the cross, but you remained until it was all finished. Give us confidence to follow you completely through our trials and crosses, because you are the author and finisher of our faith. Amen.
Let's rise for the last word. The seventh word, according to St. Luke, chapter 23, verses 44 through 46. It was now about the sixth hour, and darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour, for the sun had stopped shining. The curtain of the temple was torn in two. Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And when he had said this, he breathed his last.
Lord Jesus, when you had finished all, you handed your spirit over to your Father so that he could then give his spirit back to you. Keep us on the one truth faith that on the last day, your spirit will be given back to our mortal bodies, and we may rise to serve you in everlasting righteousness, innocence, and blessedness. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus, he hung in the darkness so that we can walk in the light. Christ was cursed, and we are blessed. Jesus was forsaken. We never will be forsaken. Christ died so that we can live. Christ was bound so that we can be free. And there's a word for all of that. It's an R word. Redeemed. That's what we are. by Christ on the cross on this Good Friday, you and I are redeemed. But even more than redeemed, we are reconciled. St. Matthew says it this way in Matthew 27, "Behold, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, the rocks were split." Josephus, a first century Jewish historian, tells us a little bit about this inner curtain in the temple, that it was 55 cubits high. And that may mean nothing to you, and that's okay. 55 cubits is about the height of a 7-story building. It was split in two, torn from top to bottom. And that tearing tells us something important about what God is doing on this Good Friday. He's telling us that he no longer needs the temple. He no longer needs the sacrifices. It's finished. Once and for all. You and I are reconciled with God the Father, no matter what we have done. We are reconciled because of what Christ has done. This is a gift that we don't achieve. It's not a gift that we work for. It's a gift that we receive. It's Christ's gospel gift to us. Friends in Christ, you and I, no matter what has happened, no matter what kind of baggage we have carried around throughout our lives, no matter what kind of mess we have gotten ourselves into, you and I, because of the events of this Good Friday, are completely reconciled and at peace with our Heavenly Father. God of all creation opens to you and I the door to eternal forgiveness. Bloodshed, violence, and nudity means that we are redeemed. It means that we are reconciled. And as we are exposed to this wonderful gift, we are renewed. Funny thing happened at the foot of the cross when Jesus breathed his last. The curtain of the temple was torn in two. There was an earthquake, but there was somebody standing by watching Jesus on the cross, a centurion. And Matthew tells us that when the centurion and those who were with him keeping watch over Jesus saw the earthquake and what had taken place, they were filled with awe. And they said, "Truly this was the Son of God." Renewal, accomplished on the cross of Calvary. Do you need to be renewed? You need to come alive again? Maybe we should mimic what the centurion said and the bystanders with him, confessing Christ, who truly is the Son of God, trusting Jesus, who he claims to be, loving Jesus, captivated by him, beholden and enamored with him. When we have that kind of a response to the gospel, the word that describes us is renewed. And it's absolutely a wonderful word. There's one more R word, resurrected. You know, it's kind of an interesting thing. When we go through the events of Holy Week, we start with Palm Sunday and the triumphal entry. Then we move toward Maundy Thursday, the mandate, the promise, the gift that God gives His church as He says, take, eat, this is my body given for you. Take, drink, this is my blood shed for you. This new covenant for the forgiveness of your sins. And then we move from that point in the service onto Good Friday as the worship continues. But on the night of the crucifixion, this Friday that we call Good, Matthew tells us that the tombs were opened and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised and coming out of the tomb. And after the resurrection, they went into the holy city, Jerusalem, and appeared to many. Can you imagine that? The death of Jesus was so powerful, on display, that His defeat of death couldn't even wait for Easter morn. Already on Good Friday, there's resurrection. It's there. The death of Jesus is the death of death itself. Friends in Christ, a day is coming. Our Savior not only promised that He would die on a cross, but He promised that He would rise in 3 days. And He did. The day is coming when our Savior, who also has promised that He will return, will show up. He's going to do it. And you and I, we too, will be resurrected. On that day, we will stand before the great throne of God, washed white in the blood of the Lamb, with every stain, wrinkle, or blemish removed from us as far as the east is from the west. And we will be holy and blameless in His sight forevermore, without shame, without guilt, completely covered and immersed in His love. The word for that is resurrected. That's you and I. Made alive again. R-rated. That's for sure, isn't it? Crucifixion, definitely. Bloodshed, violence, nudity, indecent exposure. All of that happens so that you and I can know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you and I are also redeemed, reconciled, renewed, and resurrection is coming. Make no mistake. What kind of love is this? There's one word. Starts with R that I would use to describe it, and it's the word radical. And radical is kind of a word that's been thrown around a lot, maybe haphazardly. It's become kind of a cliche, perhaps. But the word radical comes from the Latin word radix or radix, and it means root, core, center. The Good Friday giver and His gifts are radical. They are the very root, the very core of our salvation and who we are in Christ Jesus. They're the very core of our hope. And they're the very root of life eternal. Friends in Christ, nothing will ever be more important. And so on this Good Friday, these R-rated events, these R-rated gifts are yours. Straight from God's loving heart. Amen. We continue in song with O Perfect Life of Love. Thank you. Let's rise. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. As evening approached, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body, and Pilate ordered that it be given to him. Joseph took the body, wrapped it in a clean linen cloth, and placed it in his own new tomb that he had cut out of the rock. He rolled a big stone in front of the entrance to the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were sitting there opposite the tomb. The next day, the one after preparation day, the chief priests and the Pharisees went to Pilate. "Sir," they said, "we remember that while he was still alive, that deceiver said, 'After 3 days I will rise again.' So give the order for the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may come and steal the body and tell the people that he has been raised from the dead. This last deception will be worse than the first." "Take a guard," Pilate answered. "Go make the tomb as secure as you know how." So they went and made the tomb secure by putting a seal on the stone and posting the guard. This is the word of the Lord.